Today we're talking about the Iran deal, a deal that people either love or hate, leaving me in the lonely position of eh. So why are we talking about this today? Well, in the spirit of Avengers Infinity War coming out, it seems appropriate to be talking about the Middle East. Really though, a new development just came out that might need some contextualizing.
Benjamin Netanyahu has said that Iran lied about not pursuing nuclear weapons and continued to preserve and expand its stock after signing a 2015 deal with global powers.
Alright, first off, Netanyahu, what are you doing? I know you're trying to be dramatic, but when you rip the cover off something, you gotta make sure it's something more impactful than a wall of unlabeled CDs aligned in arguably the most inefficient way possible. Oh geez, Netanyahu has a smoking gun. If only any modern computer had a CD drive. The best part is, you have to remember that he planned all this out ahead of time, got an intern to line up all those CDs in a case, and argue with an advisor that, no, let's not put a helpful graphic up, instead let's show the largest collection of unlabeled CDs since people stopped using Napster. Alright. So, enough roasting the guy, let's get down to brass tacks. First of all, what is the Iran deal? So, Iran has a nuclear program, because at some point someone thought it was a good idea to give them all of the nuclear technologies. Yeah, sorry about that one everyone, but in our defense, they seemed cool at the time. Not getting into that one too much though, but that was a part of our Atoms for Peace program under Eisenhower, an attempt at internationalizing nuclear energy and the geopolitical equivalent of giving everyone a gun, but saying they can only use it for hunting. So now we come to 2015, when it turns out that maybe nuclear energy might not have been their highest priority.
A major victory for President Obama Wednesday, as the White House secured enough votes in the United States Senate to ensure the nuclear agreement survives congressional opposition.
Alright, so let's talk about the key feature of that deal. Using this conveniently titled BBC article, Iran nuclear deal key details. Alright, so first, let's talk about uranium enrichment. Because in 2015, Iran has a lot of enriched uranium. First off, what is enriched uranium? Because I'm not a chemist, so to me, enriching uranium sounds like cooking meth. When I hear someone's doing it, I generally don't think, well, this'll be good for society, and I pretty much only picture a large fiery explosion. In reality though, low enriched uranium, which has a 3% to 4% concentration of U-235, can be used to produce fuel for nuclear power plants, medicine, agriculture, industry, and science. Agriculture? Really? Bob, our crop yields are low. Well, have you tried irradiating our fields? That said, it's true. Now this definitely complicates things, because Iran wants to keep making low-level enriched uranium. And this is why you get results like,
officials have told the Associated Press that the United States is considering letting Tehran run hundreds of centrifuges at a once secret fortified underground bunker in exchange for limits on centrifuge work and research and development at other sites.
Well, before the Iran deal, in July of 2015, Iran had almost 20,000 centrifuges. Under the Iran deal, it will be limited to installing no more than 5,060 of the oldest and least efficient centrifuges. Okay, great. Now some of you might be thinking this is like entering a hostage negotiations, getting 3/4 of the hostages released, and then walking away saying, well, I'm sure the last quarter will be treated safely. Negotiators from the deal would argue that these 5,060 centrifuges are old and inefficient, and it produces a 3.67% enriched uranium, which, according to people who know more than I do, is an acceptable amount of enrichment, as opposed to the 90% enrichment required for a nuclear weapon. Again, not a chemist, but a guy who graduated from elementary school, I can definitively say that there is a large difference between 3.67 and 90%. The other point of contention is that, as I mentioned previously, pre-Iran deal Iran had enough enriched uranium to be glowing from outer space. More specifically, 15,000 pounds, or For those of you who don't like to measure nuclear capability using the same units we use for deli meat, before the Iran deal, Iran had a large stockpile of enriched uranium, enough to create 8 to 10 bombs, according to the White House. After the Iran deal, they reduced their nuclear stockpile by 98%, which, congratulations on negotiating your way into keeping 2%. Although, that 2% is low enrichment level stuff that, allegedly, won't go boom. Also, don't worry about the 98% of the nuclear stockpile, because it went to a place where it definitely won't get turned into a nuclear weapon. Russia. Iran shipped thousands of pounds of enriched uranium to Russia on Monday, a key component in the nuclear deal that had to be fulfilled. So, now let's talk about point 2, the plutonium pathway. Ah yes, plutonium, just as scary as uranium with a slightly more fun name. So in the region of Iraq, there exists a heavy water reactor that produces nuclear waste, including plutonium that could be weaponized in a nuclear weapon. First, what is a heavy water reactor? I mean, I personally thought water was pretty consistent with regards to its weight. I wonder if heavy water is more refreshing. Things get technical really quickly, so I'll spare you and myself the details. But heavy water replaces the hydrogen in water with deuterium. Wow, doing an episode on the Iran deal, I wasn't expecting to struggle most with an English word. Anyways, the heavy water is used in nuclear reactors, which are used for producing electricity and medical radiation for fighting cancer. So, what was the fate of this facility?
Iran has reportedly removed the core of its Arak heavy water nuclear reactor and filled it with cement as required under a nuclear deal signed with world powers last year. Any such move reducing the plant's ability to produce plutonium might signal imminent implementation of the nuclear deal.
Generally, filling your reactor core with cement isn't the best way to keep your nuclear energy program alive. Although, it's not dead yet, because Iran agreed to redesign the reactor so it cannot produce any weapons-grade plutonium. Well, that certainly takes the fun out of investing in nuclear energy. This led to the more recent development.
Now, Iran and China have signed a technical contract to begin the process of redesigning the Arak heavy water reactor. That Tehran regards the move as an important step in terms of implementing the nuclear deal that it signed with the P5+1 back in 2015.
Alright, so next subject. Point 3, covert activity. Ooh, this sounds fun. I love Bond movies. In this case, the name's Bond. Fission Bond. I'll have a water and make it heavy. Alright, the strange thing is that this covert activity section is about as covert as the FBI storming Michael Cohen's office. Investigators from the Industrial Atomic Energy Commission, who are the go-to for keeping an eye on countries who seem to be putting a little too much effort and money into improving their nuclear energy sector, will be monitoring all declared nuclear sites in Iran and tracking that no fission materials are moved to covert underground bomb-making sites. To add on to that, there's this whole other weird thing for the Industrial Atomic Energy Commission to get into locations that are not designated nuclear, as recently covered by John Oliver.
They also get access to any other site, military or civilian, where they suspect undeclared nuclear activity. Now, Iran can push back on those suspicions, but once the IAEA demands access, Iran has just 24 days max to let them in. And it is a pretty tall order to completely clean up every trace of an isotope with a half-life of 710 million years in just 24 days.
Specifically, if there's any suspicious activity at an undeclared site, Iran can challenge the IAEA's request to inspect the facility, leading to an arbitration process that could take up to 24 days to resolve. Now, some argue that this leads to some potential problems because, well, some countries in the council don't hate Iran as much as we do. Specifically, you need 5 out of 8 votes in that committee, and the voting countries include Iran, because, well, I'm sure they're gonna go hard on themselves, Russia, who has a pretty strong alliance with Iran, and China, who also has a pretty good relationship growing with Iran. And if you get those countries, critics would argue that all you need to do is get one more country to vote with you, and you could have complete privacy from inspectors. Although, take your pick between the other countries, because America, Great Britain, France, Germany, and the entirety of the European Union as a whole, and you'll see that this probably won't be an easy feat. Amongst them, you're about as hated as the guy who brings a bag of chips to a potluck. Upon appeal, this committee can not only grant access to investigators, but even further strike punitive measures like reinstating sanctions. Next to point 4, the breakout time. Now, the breakout time is the amount of time it would take a country to build a nuclear weapon if they were really applying themselves. Although, I'm talking about North Korean levels of applying yourself, where your citizens are starving and you're launching off rockets like it's the 4th of July. Now, before the Iran deal, Iran's breakout time was about 3 months. But with the surrendering of uranium, plutonium, research, and centrifuges, it's gone to over a year. So, hey, at least now we're guaranteed the experience of another midterm election, which, come to think of it, maybe annihilation might be an appealing alternative. Alright, so now to the final and most important piece of the puzzle. Point 5, lifting sanctions. United Nations, European Union, and American sanctions really wrecked the Iranians' economy to the point where they're willing to step away from their nuclear ambitions. And let me tell you, when you're in a region of the world where superpowers just burst in like Kramer from Seinfeld, a nuke would be quite the blessing. Estimates are that they have $100 billion in assets frozen overseas, and they lost over $160 billion in oil sales between 2012 and 2016. Which, when you're a country that can't even sell oil, that's when you know you're in trouble. The main point with these sanctions is that, should Iran violate any aspect of the deal, the UN sanctions will automatically snap back into place. I never thought I'd say this though, but unfortunately, it seems like Iran isn't trying to build nuclear weapons or violate the deal in any ways. So we're stuck with it. Alright, so now that we know what the Iran deal is, should we break up with it or should we try to work things out? An interesting problem with this is that, since 1979, economic cooperation between the United States and the Islamic Republic of Iran have been minimal. As a result, the United States could exercise its influence on the Iranian economy only through interaction with the international community. That's right, the last time we had normal trade relations with Iran, McDonald's had just released the Happy Meal. Although that is the saddest looking Happy Meal I have ever seen. And Michael Jackson was still black! What this means is that the US unilaterally threatening to stop doing business with Iran would be about as big an impact as me boycotting Tampax. Wait, so you're telling me a country that hasn't done business with us in almost 40 years might refuse to do business with us again? Oh no, this will be devastating! The real painful part of the sanctions was America calling our buddies. And, like a group of mean girls at a school lunch, telling them not to talk to Iran anymore. With the most painful sanctions coming from Europe, China, and Russia. You know, countries that have actually done business with that country during the last generation. Another reason not to leave is that leaving a deal when the other party hasn't broken it has the potential to hurt the US's reputation. Nobody wants to make a 20-year agreement with someone if you're not sure whether it'll last a year. And some are worried that us leaving this agreement will hurt our chances at denuclearizing North Korea. Although, I have to point out that specifically, Pompeo has gone on the record to say that Kim Jong-un is fine with the agreement. Probably because he treats nuclear treaties with about as much reverence as teenagers treat copyright agreements. So, what are the arguments for leaving the agreement? Well, first, since the deal was signed, Iran has conducted several provocative ballistic missile tests. Game over right there. That sounds like it's breaking all sorts of rules. Let's bring back those sanctions. Well, the problem is that these aren't nuclear warheads, so they're technically legal. This is why you hear people saying that Iran is violating the spirit of the deal. It's like telling your girlfriend you can't sleep with other guys and then hearing she's just kissing them. It's violating the spirit of what you were trying to do, but when you leave things up to interpretation in legally binding documents, people tend to liberally interpret them. Now, the other argument against it is that they have the 8th largest army in the world, and making it so that this massive country is no longer perpetually on the edge of serious financial problems puts our allies in danger. Because if there's anything I've learned from looking at the Middle East, it's that stability comes from struggling states with massive armies. Last, this deal is going to start expiring in 10 years, so the underlying problem is not being solved. While it does delay the conflict, critics would argue that instead of actually accomplishing anything, this would be like having a baby and thinking, well, I don't have to worry about paying for college because what? That's like 18 years away. And who knows, maybe by then we'll have tuition-free universities. So now let's get to this whole Netanyahu update, because if he's saying what the headlines seem to indicate he's saying, well, then we have an out where all participating countries might automatically have to reimpose all sanctions. So what did he say? Netanyahu presented evidence that in the years before the nuclear agreement, Iran was working on nuclear weapons while claiming to be pursuing civilian nuclear power. Netanyahu did not allege that the program had been active since the deal began. Well, I hate to say it because I thought he would have had some decent material prepared before he went on stage, but this feels like it wouldn't have even been breaking news 2 years ago when it was actually relevant. Wait, what? So you're telling me before the nuclear deal, Iran had a secret nuclear program? Well, if they didn't have a secret nuclear program, then making a nuclear deal with them would be incredibly stupid. And furthermore, you're telling me that we have no evidence that they continued their nuclear program once that deal was signed? Great! Well, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed that last video. For more episodes of That's All I Have to Say About That, click here. And please click here to subscribe, and remember to like below. And if you're really a fan, you can join our Facebook group. It's just a party over there.